Both are a little handsome. You gotta be able to cast. In the winter time, when you can't, when in the winter time, you freezer up the bank too, so you can really open it up. In the fall, I can just wait in there with my patients and whatever.
Well, we'll get started here in just a few minutes.
Yeah.
That's not coming.
Hi, sweetheart.
I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry.
What, honey?
I'm sorry, I never made it over there.
Say that again?
I said, I'm sorry, I never made it over there.
Oh. It's not like what happened to you.
Show these books now, they're good.
It's not like you don't have anything else to do.
Yes, it's an orange starting to grow. I got all seven of the ones down in the meadows on videotape.
Did you?
They were Brenda's backyard.
You showed me from my backyard.
Huh?
Steve does my backyard, by the way, I just wanted for you to know.
Steve?
I'm not Steve.
You won't be thinking of me.
I was saying, that's pretty impressive.
Greg does my, he comes down.
He's coming down from heaven and mowing, yeah.
Not till I get my lawn, riding lawnmower back.
But who were you referring to?
Comes down to rest. My backyard is so overgrown and I call it God's little acre, cause it's just weeds, you know.
I forgot my Bible.
Greg mows it and his mower broke, so my backyard is looking pretty bad.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I saw you push mowing last night after we got home.
Yeah, and it does not even self-propel. It gets me sweating.
Should borrow mine and mow it down, so.
Anyways,
thank you,
anyways, it was broke down. I had to pull the carburetor part on it, and then the lever was broke, so I got a piece of foam stuck in the throttle control.
Oh.
to get the right RPMs on it.
You silly guy.
And my weed eater's hanging on by a thread, too. I'm hoping my hospital bill's not too big. And then I hope my lawnmower can get fixed. And then I go out and buy a new weed eater. I'm going to get a steel this next time.
Yeah, I certainly like mine.
Yeah,
steel's a workhorse.
I do not want electric. I've ran some of those.
No.
You have no power when you get the thicker stuff. And it just...
Yeah, it maxes out.
And I want to get them while they're still legal to buy, because sooner or later they're going to... I went to Home Depot. They only had four gas lawnmowers, two self-propelled and two that were push gas. But they had like 10 or 12 that were all battery. They're all going to battery everywhere.
Yeah.
And I don't like it. Because what, 5 years later, you got to spend another $100, $150 on a new battery?
You think it's going to be only $150?
I don't know. I'm talking about not riding lawnmowers.
It's crazy what they charge for the batteries now. So, because that's what's available. So, yeah, it's really kind
of
interesting to see what's happening. So, for sure,
right? We're making more,
throwing them over the bank,
more waste than we used to have.
Yeah. When you actually look at the carbon footprint of both the battery operated ones are just as dirty as the others, if not more so, because of where some of those batteries are created. And they don't have the standards. They don't have the standards here that we do in America. So, you know, if you're gonna make it here. But yeah, it kind of seems a little backward. Yeah. No, we'll never get away from oil. Never.
Oh, not according to Biden. Oh.
So, well, it's just not even possible. Are you gonna be the first one that gets in the battery-operated airplane to go to Hawaii?
We're going to have to start putting...
I'm not.
You need it. We're going to start getting windmills on the cars with solar panels. So when you drive, the windmill's going. It doesn't slow you down at all, though. Aerodynamic windmills on the top of your cars.
All right. Well, good morning, all.
Good morning.
It is good to see you. How come nobody's sitting over here in the 100 degree section? The good news is that as we move into summer, we get more shade going that way because the sun comes up earlier. So, anyway, but then the last time we were out here, it was only like you know, 62 degrees, so. Welcome to summer, so. Hey, I'm glad you guys could join us. Let's pray. We'll give our day to the Lord, and we'll get started. So, Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We do pray, Father, that folks would be careful in the heat, and that you would help them to make wise decisions when it comes to the things that they're doing outside. Father, we thank you for this time that we can be in your word. And even though today's might seem like a simple idea or understanding, Lord, I pray that we would provide, we would, I guess you could say, just in practicality, place this into our lives in a different way so that we would learn to love others and be careful with what we're doing. Lord, I am grateful that you are on the throne, because as we look around the world and we see things that are going on, Father, it can be somewhat nerve-wracking for folks, but Lord, your word also tells us to not worry and to not be fearful, but rather to rejoice in you, to thank you, and let the peace that passes understanding guard our hearts and minds. And so today, Lord, as we spend time worshiping you and praising your name, Lord, we think about your soon coming, and we look forward to that. But until that day, Lord, let us be faithful to share. Let us be faithful to lead people toward you before it is too late. And again, Father, we give this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, prayer requests. We have the Operation Christmas Child Program, so the little container with the coin. Keep collecting your coins and tossing them in there for that. This year is going by a lot faster than you think. I mean, we're already here at the end of June, and it's kind of amazing how quick. So usually right around September is when they start kind of trying to remind people of when the upcoming events for Operation Christmas Child take place. So keep that in mind and keep praying for those families. Again, pray for our government. Just this morning, Biden was addressing many at the G7 conference, which is just that global conference that everybody who is anybody in the leadership role in the world goes to, and basically we're saying we're going to do all kinds of, we're going to spend billions and billions of dollars on all kinds of different things that have nothing to do with America, but it's supposed to create American jobs, which doesn't make sense. Because most of the things that he was putting out there as far as things that we're going to build are probably not parts that are made here in America. So a lot of it doesn't make any sense as far as that type of thing. What does make sense is that we are moving toward that global governing situation where America is not the leader, it's just part of a conglomerate. And so we are watching that form more and more and more every day. So be praying for our government. Be praying for those that are in the government to be wise, and that they would get saved and that they would understand what's really going on. But then also pray for our local folks as well. We don't want to leave them out by any stretch. It's tough living on the river when you have fuel costs where they're at in this nation. But I got to hand it to Kathy. She's done a great job. We've got some of the best fuel prices in all of Siskiyou County. So, you know, one thing that we're good at here in Happy Camp is kind of sticking together and helping each other out most of the time. So keep praying for our communities. As far as other medical health and that kind of stuff, again, those with cancer, Jim, Dory, Larry Gabbert, Frank, and Bert. So continue to pray for those, and that the Lord would meet their needs, lead them in the ways that they should go, that the doctors would find progress in healing, and that kind of stuff. So continue to pray for them. Jimmy with back problems, and of course you know Dolly with knee issues and things of that nature. Buster for health. Again, with fire season coming up, pray for those employees that are needed. I know that some people have already come to the district and said, oh, this isn't what I thought it was going to be, and they've already quit. So Syed, I think, has maybe two people there on that engine. So it's really kind of a difficult thing right now for, and I wouldn't say that that's, we're kind of outside the box. That's what's happening all over the place, in fire everywhere. So keep praying for that situation, especially when today is supposed to be 105 and we're coming up on the 4th of July here, and people like to light stuff on fire, you know, the big sparkly. So be praying for them and their safety, things of that nature. Stan in Virginia, their health needs. I got to go surfing yesterday with my dad. The waves were beautiful. It was perfect as we got away for not just my birthday, but also for Cade's birthday. So he's a whopping 3 years old.
Wow.
So it did sound kind of funny when we were talking yesterday. My dad and I are 25 years apart. And I said, but Cade and I are 50 years apart. And it just kind of sounded like, wow, that's a considerable distance. But you know how it is. You don't ever really feel older in your mind than about 33, 35, something like that. So you never really grow old, you know. Your body just might look that way. So so anyway, my dad did really well. He's doing well. But continue to pray for his health. Denny and Donna, and the issues that they are dealing with dementia and Parkinson's, that kind of stuff. Judy Peabody's mom for health. Terry Everett and his health needs. Steve and Fran Smith with ALS issues. Candace with lupus. Debbie Taylor's mom. You want to give us a brief update? Still need prayer. Okay, so keep praying for that. Dan Bushy, who's just rolling up. Continue to pray for his medical needs. Christopher, whose wife is in Ukraine still, I believe, David, that situation hasn't changed much?
Hasn't changed.
Okay, so we'll keep praying there. And Brenda, for her health needs. And whatnot. So I'm glad to see you here.
She's doing great.
That's awesome. Glad to hear it. Again, the Clapper Church, pray for those that are joining in on those. What's that?
I am speaking tonight.
Woo! Are you?
Good.
All right.
Yeah, I'm going to be speaking on the F word.
On the F word, faith.
Forgiveness.
Oh, forgiveness. So, that's great.
That's after you use the F word, though, right?
And then Jean, that's Dory's cousin, having strokes. How's that going?
Still the same,
poor guy.
Yeah.
So keep praying for that. Vicky, sister-in-law Joni.
I just had surgery to find out what kind of treatment she's going to get.
Okay, find out what kind of treatments is going to happen there. Okay, hang on just a sec. Mark with diabetic issues. Our unsaved loved ones, specifically named, was Jean and John. So keep praying for them. The VBS situations that, you know, are going to go on during the summer for the churches. Pray that the kids would hear the word and they would understand, and that they would make Jesus leader and Lord of their life. Again, just continue to pray for churches in general, that they would stick to the word. And Bob brought up navigators. Pray for them and their ministry specifically. And then other prayer requests. Let's keep them short because it is getting warm. So
Donna
Kenny McCauley's daughter. Mm-hmm. I forget her name, but she's got...
Donita,
she's got cancer.
Oh. She passed away.
No.
Yeah, there were a couple of people that passed away here recently. So, speaking of that, those that have experienced loss and whatnot that you know, keep praying for them. So, yeah. So, Jody?
The people in the community that are having homes built by the people up there, I heard that they lost one of their contractors that was working on foundations.
Yeah,
that's the start of it.
That's a hard one. So, yeah. So it's such a long process that things change dramatically, and now that the prices of fuel and everything else have gone up, it makes a big difference on whether they can do it or not. So, yeah, pray for that, because our folks here need that assistance and that help. So,
And they've had such a roller coaster ride already that
certainly have.
The depression and the stress.
Yes, definitely. So, others. Okay, well, let's pray, and Brendan, oh no, you already brought that one up. Okay, never mind. So, okay.
One more.
Yes.
Can you add Richie Holm?
So, I can.
Yeah, because Tommy said it's okay to go ahead and pray for him.
All right. I don't know if she meant that personally or if she meant that corporately. Okay. So, anyway, Richie Hahn got into an ATV accident, and anyway, he's doing okay, so, you know, he's just got some injuries from that, so pray that his recovery would go smoothly and well in that regard. Those can be kind of dangerous, even though you don't necessarily see maybe quite so many outward issues, it's the inward that cause most of the problems, so... Okay, well, let's pray for these, and then we'll keep moving along. So, Father, thank you so much that you hear our prayers. I thank you, Lord, that you tell us that you are attentive unto our prayer. Mm-hmm. And David rejoiced that you were so attentive. Mm-hmm. Father, we are so grateful to serve you, a God who does listen, a God whose hand is not short, that he cannot reach down and touch us. And so this morning, Lord, we just say thank you that we can offer up these requests to you, knowing, Lord, that you are concerned. You are at work in each of these situations. And so, Father, we thank you that in this life, when it comes to tribulation and trouble and difficulty, we can get down on our knees and we can come to you in prayer and just lay it all out there and say we need help. And I know, Lord, your word tells us that when we call upon your name, you are there to save. And so, Father, we give these to you. We ask blessing on the people that have these needs. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Bible studies that are going on throughout the week, the men's prayer breakfast, Friday, 7 a.m. at the Bible Church, and...
Lou's favorite, biscuits and gravy.
Biscuits and gravy.
Thanks,
man. So...
Someday, Lou.
You know, I had some of those yesterday, like some biscuits and gravy, right. So good. Additionally, the women's Bible study... Thursdays at 10 a.m. However, they might be moving towards an evening service as well to incorporate many more ladies that would be available during that time. That is Thursdays now at 10 a.m. at the Bible Church. So you can pop into that, and I'll keep you informed on those things. Additionally, for the youth, David is now in a position to start up Wednesday nights at...
6 o'clock.
At 6 o'clock. The swimming pool is all set up, etc. So if you identify as a junior high or high schooler, then you can go to that study.
I will be there.
So
and you have to fall under my
authority. That's true. So anyhow. So be praying for our youth. And that study as well. So as well as just our Sunday schools here on Sunday mornings for the little ones and for our youth. No birthdays today unless somebody has been keeping secrets for years and whatnot. So, but let's have some worship and then we'll get into some of our teaching. And Walter, I'm glad you could make it. So, and I'm glad you found some shade there too. So there's a little bit left. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. What does that really mean? Waiting upon the Lord, like you're waiting for your burger, or you're waiting for DoorDash, you know, to show up because you were too lazy to go out and drive to the restaurant. No, it just simply means, Lord, I'm going to wait to see what you'll do and what you're going to do in situations. And so, that's not always an easy thing to do, is it? So. We need the Lord to open our eyes and our hearts sometimes to kind of show us what's really going on. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you. Sing that again. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power. As we sing, holy, 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 holy. as we sing holy, 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 I want to see you. Oh, holy, 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 holy. I kind of like the fact that God calls us his children. Because we tend to go a lot easier on children than we do adults, don't we? There's a lot more grace given to kids in that regard. So, although I wouldn't mind having a little less grace on this fly that's bothering me, but...
We shoot them over to you.
I see the works of your hands, galaxies spin in a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering. All that you are is so overwhelming. Delight myself in you, delighted by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your it is sometimes overwhelming how good you are to us and what you have done for us. Father, we look around and we see the beauty that you have created around us. We see the beauty that you have made in each one of us and in our kids. And Father, we thank you that you call us your children and that you see beauty, you see value in each of us. You have redeemed us because of that value. And Father, I am so grateful in today's world where life is not valuable, that Father, you look at every life as valuable. And I pray that we would do the same, that we would continue to remember, Lord, that in you we have life and life more abundantly, that you have set us free, and if we are free, we are free indeed. And we will continue, Lord, to just share your goodness and your glory and your grace and your mercy and your forgiveness. We thank you, Lord. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we'll go ahead and dismiss the Sunday school and youth group. Go ahead, Greg. You know, if they were having basketball, we'd probably both be there.
My brain knows what to do. My body doesn't work anymore.
So. I think I swallowed a little too much salt water yesterday. So. It was a beautiful day. What's that? Oh man, it was like perfect weather. So it was absolutely wonderful. So, well, we're gonna talk briefly. I know I use that term loosely about Israel. Give you a kind of a little prophecy update here, because the last week, the things that have been going on, even after last Sunday, I told you keep your eyes on Israel, keep your eyes on things that are going on there. Besides the things that are going on in the world today, because Israel is God's timepiece when it comes to his return. And so what has been happening in this world, we talked last week that there's been a real pushing away of Israel here in America. Well, just this week, North Carolina, the Democratic Party has drafted resolutions concerning human rights. They accuse Israel of apartheid. And obviously they are not really clued into who Israel is and what apartheid really means. Yeah. We're talking about racism, and Israel is like the furthest thing from racism. There is so many ethnicities there that even their own legislature, their own government, the third largest party, you know, we have the Republican Party and the Democratic Party and the Independent and the Green and the, I mean, there's a lot of different things. But the third largest is actually Arab. So the people that are kind of complaining over there are the ones that are the third largest in their government. So it's really to say that they are an apartheid position or state is just simply false and just sheer lies. Also, you might recall that prior to the 67 war, that five-day war where Yasser Arafat and some of those boys that were over there thought that they were going to come in, pound Israel, and just take everything back, in theory, which they didn't want it anyway, because what had happened to the land? You remember that the trees were all cut down, all of the dirt and the farmland was salted. You couldn't grow anything there. It was a wasteland. And so, you know, when the Ottoman Empire, when England said, hey, we'll return this to you because of what you did in helping us win the war to the Jewish scientist who came up with the atom bomb and things of that nature and some of the science that had been kind of new and given to governments in order to defeat the Communist Party at that time. They just simply asked him, what do you want? He said, I want my homeland back. So in repayment, Israel got their land back, the land that God gave to Abraham, to Isaac and Jacob, gave to those people. So 5-day war happens. Yasser Arafat basically told everybody, you know, if you get out of the land right now where the Jews have come back into, of course, when they came back in May 14th, 1948, I mean, they went right to war that fast. And again, Israel won, even though they didn't have much. But in 67, 5-day war, they were, the Palestinians that were what we're referring to today as Palestinians were told, if you leave, then when we win the war, you can come back and you can have first choice of the land that you want. Well, guess what happened? They didn't win. So all those people were refugees, and Israel took back more of the land that was literally theirs. And so they were, many of those were left as refugees. Many of those were also invited back to the land to purchase land and to have help. Israel really helped out tremendously. Well, since May 14th of 1948, Israel has been attacked almost daily in some way, shape, or form. And now the Democratic Party in North Carolina is voting on particular issues that would be considered what they consider to be pertinent issues. So there are some restricted areas that the Jews cannot even go in their own land right now, most of which are like the Jewish temple. You know, they've been trying to restrict that. The police are out there stopping them from going during Palestinian celebrations and things of that nature. But it is interesting in this whole idea of Palestinian state, how many elections have been held as far as the leadership for the Palestinian people? How many elections? Zero. So what kind of freedom do they really have? You know, their own government that are running them don't even give them the power to vote. So leadership over there is, for the Palestinian people, a joke. Well, this resolution accuses Israel of displacing the Palestinians. And Palestine, which is where the Philistines, which is where that word comes from. Who was the Philistine that's like the most popular Philistine that we know?
Goliath.
You know, the big guy. And then little bitty David, shepherd boy, come out there. Goliath's got a big old spear and a big old sword.
Yeah.
And what happened? Yes, Goliath lost. You know, a little bitty stone, you know, hits him between the eyes. And then David probably took all of his strength to lift that sword and chop Goliath's head off. Well, how come David brought five stones? Because Goliath had brothers.
Oh.
And, you know, if you take one out, but here's the thing. If you see somebody that's that good a shot, you're probably just going to be like, well, sorry, Goliath, you're the one that picked the fight, so we're out of here. They all left. And again, when you go to war and you lose, you can't be the sore loser. So really this idea of Palestine comes from all the way back then. Not even all the way back to Abraham. God gave the land to Abraham, and yet people have been trying to take it back ever since. So I'm getting a little off track here from the resolution, but just like anybody, they want to protect, Israel wants to protect their borders, and the Democrats do not believe that they have the right to protect their borders. They think that they should just let anybody in. The problem is people try and come in all the time and blow up their family members. Well, they're not going to do that. They're not going to let that in. They want the U.S. to withhold aid and weapons, but yet just this morning, Biden is saying, oh, we're going to give a whole bunch of people a lot of American money, but, you know, the Democrats on this side are saying, yeah, but don't support Israel anymore. And you know, we've talked about this over the last few weeks, that those who bless Israel, God said, I will what?
Bless.
I will bless. And those who curse Israel, I will curse. So, you know, if we are going to do that, America is in big trouble as far as that goes. So, there are a lot of things going on
as far as that goes, but we'll move on from there. Another thing that happened, remember last week we spoke briefly on Israel selling natural gas to Europe in order to keep their machine going because they were highly dependent on Russian oil. Well, Russia has, of course, threatened to shut off those people. Germany happens to be like almost 90% reliant upon Russia. What have they said during this whole time? Nothing. They've kind of kept their mouth shut. Why? Because they don't want the lights out. I don't know about you, but I like the electricity. I like that. I like having those things. And a lot of our electricity comes from the burning of fossil fuels and that kind of thing. Europe is saying, hey, we're going to have to go back to coal. You know, speaking of the dark ages and things like that, we're going to have to start doing some of these things in order to do that. Well, Israel is selling them natural gas to keep the lights on. But then this past week, Lithuania has been threatened. There is a railroad line that goes from Russia to the coastline, which is only warm water coast that's out there, the Baltic Sea. And Russia allowed Lithuania to become a NATO, and I say this very interestingly, they allowed them to. There's no way that Lithuania has any kind of weapons that could, you know, keep Russia at bay. That's just impossible. Russia said, we'll let you join NATO, but you cannot restrict our rail lines that go from the Baltic Sea over here. We need our goods, we need our stuff, and you can do that, but you have got to leave that open. Well, guess what Lithuania has been doing? They've been holding up some of those shipments, about half of them actually, and Russia is now saying, if you don't stop this, we will attack you. And if you know anything about NATO, those that are part of NATO have to join in the fight if one of the partners is attacked. So if Russia attacks Lithuania, and that's like a David and Goliath type situation, what do you think is going to happen here in America? You think oil prices are bad now, yeah. which much of is engineered, okay, because they want us to use something different. they're going to try and save the environment, and it's just going to be mostly America that does it all. It's not going to happen. So the scripture even indicates that. So here's the thing. If they attack, we're going to be, you know, head over heels into this war big time, and it's going to be pretty nasty as far as that goes. So Lithuania is in a bit of a conundrum, to say the least. Iran, of course, you know we've been talking, they have had nuclear capabilities now for probably a month or so, and they are real close to actually having a way to deliver that, like realistically deliver that. And much of that's because who is their buddy? Russia. And what did we already talk about? That Russia a couple weeks or a few weeks ago said, look, all it would take was two Satan missiles. They nicknamed it Satan. All it would take is, you know, two Satan missiles in 30 minutes. America's done. Okay? Because they could hit our East Coast. You're talking about New York and some strategic things there. And that's it. It's over. You know, our economy's shot. Nothing's moving. Our government may be taken out, that kind of thing. So this is a very heated deal. But Israel has known for years that Iran wants them off of the face of the planet. But does Israel have all of their ducks in a row? You'd think that they would, right? But you might recall that a while back, they were arguing amongst themselves, and they decided that after 8 years of Benjamin or Bibi Netanyahu, that they didn't want that kind of government. They didn't want a conservative government. They wanted to be inclusive, which kind of is strange in light of what the North Carolina Democrats are saying. Hey, they're not inclusive. The government that they had for the last year and a half has said, no, we want all sorts of input from all sorts of... Well, in their Knesset, in their government, you have to have 59 like votes in order to pass anything. And that can be hard to do when you have an all-inclusive type situation, unless it's something that we can all agree upon. Just like the Democrats and Republicans. If you have mostly Democrats, hey, you can get things passed. If you have mostly Republicans, you can get the things done that you want. Well, in the Knesset, if you don't have the 59 that you need, or if you don't have the 61, rather, that you need, and you only have 59, what's going to happen in that government? It's a lame duck, right? It's not going to go anywhere. It's not going to be able to accomplish anything. But this is what the people elected after falsely accusing Netanyahu of a bunch of crimes that he didn't commit. Sound familiar? Mm-hmm. That sounds exactly what happened in this country when they attacked a president, obviously Trump, who's, you know, hey, he's a Russian collaborator and whatnot. So I don't care where you stand, whether you're conservative, liberal, whether you are, you know, when you accuse somebody falsely, it's just wrong. We know that Trump had a loud mouth. They didn't like him. He was a bit mean at times. It's not my cup of tea, but he stood for things that are right in a lot of ways. Well, the same was true with Bibi Netanyahu. Well, the government just this week fell apart in Israel. The whole thing just collapsed. Naftali Bennett, who was the prime minister, basically said, I quit. I'm done. That's it. It's over. Thank you for the $13 million that you spent on my house, but I'm done. And so now that is getting handed off to a kind of, I guess you could say, more of a vice-type prime minister. Again, because they don't have the votes, there's nothing that's going to happen. So they're going to have to go through a bunch of elections again. Now, Netanyahu has stepped up and said, we want elections now. We need the government functioning now. We cannot wait until what you guys have said, well, we're going to wait until October, and then we'll hold elections. Well, can you imagine if the government collapsed here in America, and then we said, we're just going to wait until October or November in order to make any... What do you think is going to happen? It's just going to be an all-out crazy whatever. So their government is in shambles. Our government is going nowhere. It's just, it's really kind of interesting to see, because what did the Lord say was going to happen in the last days? That everybody would be looking for some form of government to lead them. They wanted leadership. And they won't find it in the Antichrist either. We'll see what happens. So, now the next prime minister, or the interim prime minister, is Yair Lapid. I'm not sure how you say his name, but until the elections are there. let's see here. We already talked about that. Meanwhile, Israel is going through the largest war drills in their entire history. Why? Because Iran has a nuclear bomb. Okay, they are worried that that is going to be deployed. So they are being very, very careful. They are calling this drill Chariots of Fire, which brings up a great song. You know, yes. As you're running down the beach in slow motion, you know, that kind of thing. But anyway, they're worried about Iran. And they already know that they do have some very intelligent minds in Iran. Obviously, they can come up with missiles, and they can come up with nuclear material, enrich it to the point of creating a bomb. But also, Israel has a new missile alert system within the community. Well, guess who hacked it? Oh. Iran. Iran hacked their system, set off their alarms. They didn't set off any. They don't have the ability to set off the... the missiles or anything of that nature, but it really kind of put them a little bit, makes them a little uneasy, to say the least, when it comes to that kind of thing. So our Navy ships are in the Persian Gulf, which we have been for many, many years. But earlier this week, perhaps you saw that on the news as well, there were several, I think four or five Iranian speedboats that came and approached very closely. I don't have that kind of patience. I would have just like, you know, did a little cannonball right in front of their boat and saw what happened, you know. But all we did was kind of give them warning signs. But they're becoming much more aggressive, even to us here in America in that regard. So there's a lot of things that are happening in this world. We talked about them last week as well. But the Lord said, when you see these things, wars, rumors of wars, like we talked about last week, the Lord said, these are the beginning of the birth pangs. So we're starting to see these things really begin to unfold. Now, we could become very uneasy when we see these things happening. But here's the thing. You and I serve a God that is powerful, a God that has a plan for you and I. And he says, look, don't worry about it. They that wait upon me, those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. And so our job is just to wait upon the Lord, which is what we're doing today. And it's a great thing to see. But so when we see these things, know that, hey, the Lord is coming back soon. Just as a woman travails in birth, hey, the world is going to go through some travail before the Son of God comes, and we see the promises that Jesus fulfilled or will be fulfilled, as he said in his word. So, all right, well, today's message, of course, I forgot to mention that, yes, the Supreme Court overturned the federal right for a woman to have an abortion, the whole Roe versus Wade. Of course, I don't know. I've read the Constitution many times. There is nothing that talks about abortion in the thing. So it's going to get kicked back to the states. But, it, you know, it never ceases to amaze me the absurdity of the arguments that people bring out during these type of situations. That a woman would not have the right to an abortion if she had an ectopic pregnancy. That's a lie. Okay, an ectopic pregnancy for a woman will kill her. And so the doctors will save a life, even though they can't save one. They will try and save the most viable life. It's just the way it works. In EMS, you have the black tarp, you have the green tarp, you have the yellow tarp, and you have the red tarp. I'm sorry, if you're not saved, or if you're unsavable, if you're unsavable, you know, there's no way that you're gonna make it at all. Then we don't do CPR on you in a mass casualty situation. It's just not gonna happen. You're gonna get moved over here to the black tarp. If you're savable, you get to sit on the green tarp. And sorry, but you're gonna be the last one served. And then the yellow, hang in there. We'll get to you after we get to all the red ones. You know, that's the way it works. Doctors are not going to deny women life when they know for a fact that the baby that they are having is going to kill them. That is not the issue at all. The issue is that we in America have agreed to just go ahead and look at life as not really life. Until when? Till we want it to be. You recall that a while ago, I think it was Maryland we talked about, that they had a Senate bill before them that you had up to so many weeks after the child was born that you can decide whether you want it or not. And then you can kill it that way. And then what do the doctors say? Well, we'll make it comfortable through this process. You got to be kidding me. We are flat out murdering people in this land, and it's just nuts. America has done some evil things over the years, and we know that, okay? But it started out not that way. It started out as a godly Christian nation, one of love, one of inclusivity. But what happened? We let the devil in.
Yep.
And what happened? We kick God out, we let Satan in, and Satan is here to, what does the scripture say?
Steal,
kill, and destroy. Okay, we need God back in this nation so desperately that without him, we will and are nothing. And so we need to remember that our job isn't so much to argue these things out, but to love people through these things. And so we're going to jump into something that seems a little bit different for us, because we know the scriptures, you guys know them well, but we're going to turn to, because that's where we're at in our chapter by chapter, verse by verse teaching through the scriptures. We are in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, so if you want to tune there in your device or your Bible, if you don't have one, I think there's some Bibles back there on the table. You can grab one of those and join with us. So chapter 8. Let me tell a joke first. You know, we went from heavy to let's go to something light and cheery and funny. All right, well, there was a rabbi, a priest, and a minister that were discussing the giving in their churches and how they, you know, kind of dealt with some of the issues of need and whatnot. And well, the priest said, well, this is what we do at our church. You know, we draw a circle on the ground and we throw the money up in the air, and whatever lands inside the circle, that's what we hang on to, and the rest we give to God that's outside the circle. The minister says, well, you know, we do something very similar, except that, you know, we throw the money up into the air and whatever lands outside the circle is ours, and whatever's inside the circle we give to God. And then the rabbi says, well, you know, we kind of do something similar too. We throw the money up in the air, and whatever God wants, he can keep. Okay. Paul has been talking about practical issues in the church, our actions inside the church, whether it's lawsuits or marriage, singleness, whatever it might be. And then Paul begins to answer some of their questions. And today's has to do with food. So today's title is, Let's Eat. And we'll try and keep this to half an hour. That way you're out ready for lunch. Okay? So, now regarding your question about food, Paul would say, that has been offered to idols, yes, we know that we, quote, have all knowledge about this issue. But while knowledge makes us feel important or puffed up, it is love that strengthens the church. Anyone who claims to know all the answers doesn't really know much. But the person who loves God is the one whom God recognizes. Now we're talking about the city of Corinth. What was a big thing for the city of Corinth? Idolatry. Man, they had idols, you know, everywhere. They even had one that says to the unknown God, just in case they forgot one. You know, they didn't want to upset any of the gods, so they said, you know what, let's make idols, let's worship them. But, I mean, literally, can you tell me what a rock has done for you? I mean, did they get up and pay your bills? Did they put fuel in the tank? Did that? What about a log or a stick? Or, I mean, has that done anything for you?
Keep my house warm.
So it might keep your house warm, right? But did it get up and do that for you? You know, what about a picture hanging on a wall, you know, that's somebody's face? Or some star out in the galaxy? What has any of that done for you? Nothing. So Paul's saying we need to be realistic about this. So in a way, he's saying, I want you to listen to what you're saying. You're setting up idols. You are setting up idols. The idols didn't erect themselves. You're setting them up yourself. And even though we have a bunch of knowledge about this issue, knowledge puffs up. Well, if you puff something up, what's inside of it?
Air.
It's emptiness. So even though you might have a lot of knowledge about this, that doesn't really mean anything. Okay, that's emptiness. We might have a lot of knowledge when it comes to this kind of stuff, but what really fills the balloon? It isn't water, but the Word, right? Which the Word is the water, so I guess you could say it's full of the water. So the Lord simply says, it's love. It's love, my love. How do they know that we are Christians? By our love for one another. So this issue isn't about idols. This issue isn't about gods. This issue isn't even about, hey, let's eat. But it's really, let's love. That's what he's going to talk about. And so in Corinth, a lot of people were worshiping idols. And Paul says, yes, I've got the answer. But the answer isn't my direction. It's obedience and love to the Lord. So verse 4. So what about eating meat that has been offered to idols? Well, this is real simple. What they would do is, you know, they would take a lamb or a sheep or a goat or whatever it might have been. They would, you know, cut it apart, put it on their idols. They would offer it to the god. And when they were done, they would divide it up. Some would go to the priest or priests that were performing the ceremonies to that idol. Some would go to the idol itself, which means that it would just rot there. And then the other part would be sold in the marketplace or at the restaurants that, you know, would be available during that time. And so you had the option to go into the marketplace or to the restaurant, and you could have a prime rib dinner for $7.95, just like Vegas, you know. I mean, it was cheap. Who doesn't love a good sale, right? You know, of course, everything's for sale, so you just have to pay money for it. Well, Paul would say here simply, when it comes to this, we'll address this. Well, we all know that an idol is not really a god and that there is only one God, which means the opposite. When in the Jewish writings, a lot of times when they would make a statement, the opposite of that statement is true. So we all know that an idol is not really a god, which means also that there were people that actually believed that they were gods. These people would come to church, they would get saved, and now that they're saved because they found the one true God, God the Father, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, when they found him, they still had this idea in the back of their minds that somehow or another, idols came with a god. And I love what Dickey says, you are only as powerful as the god that you serve. So if you're serving a rock like the ones that are laying out here in the parking lot, how powerful are you? Well, they're not doing anything, they're just laying around, you know. Here's the thing, you truly are only as powerful as the god that you serve. Christ is in you, and if Christ is in you, you have power at your hands, not to wield wield swords and go to war, but to do what? They will know that you are Christians by your love. Okay, that is the law. That is what we use. We need to love. And so Paul's trying to get this idea across that there's still some people that are young in the Lord that don't really understand this issue. And so there may be some that they believe that this is the case. So there may be so-called gods both in heaven and on earth, and some people actually worship many of the gods and many lords. Does the scripture say that there are other gods? Yes, it does. We don't often realize that the scripture does talk about that, but in many of the scriptures, we'll get to, I don't know which slide I put my scripture verse, but the Lord talks about, mostly about judges that are gods, because they might as well be. If you've broken the law and you go sit before a judge, they have the power of life and death over you, don't they? You know, guilty or not guilty. And in that day, they didn't mess around a whole lot as we do today. Now you can kill somebody, go to jail, here in California anyway, and you can get right out in 5 minutes, it seems like. It's really kind of a shame. Well, in that day and age, they didn't mess around. So in a sense, they were the lords. They were the gods over your life. You were either going to die or live. And so in that way, but in no way, shape, or form does the scriptures ever indicate that gods are anything more than what God has appointed to be lords over the people, judges over the people. And so in that regard, the scripture never says that there is, in a sense, other gods except for one. Who is that? Jesus. Satan. Satan. That's the other gods. Okay? He is the god of what? This world. So if you're going to serve him, then whatever's happening here is the best that it's going to get, and that's the most power that you're ever going to have, in a sense. And is this world in a good place? No, it's falling apart. And it just keeps going around and around and around. We keep doing the same thing over and over and over. Because Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He just wants to wipe out everything and everybody. But, verse 6, but for us, there is one God, capital G, one God, the Father, by whom all things were created and for whom we live. Hebrews tells us that all things were created by him and for him. Who is that? Jesus Christ. Okay? He is God. And there is one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things were created, which is reiterated here. And through whom we, what? Live. Is God a judge over you and I? Yeah. He died one time for how many of the sins of the world? All of them. So you are all forgiven. Everybody is forgiven, which leaves you with one thing. You get to make a choice. You're either going to serve the God of this world or you're going to serve the God of heaven. You're either going to serve Jesus or Satan. But that's all that's left. You have the choice. And I like that because I like my life simple. I like it simple. Just tell me yes or no. Tell me number one or number two. When I was a little baby, my mom would put me in the playpen, and they would start tossing a bunch of toys in, and I would start crying. Way too many choices. And they would only leave me with two or three, and then I was happy. But you start, I didn't know which way to turn. I like it simple. I have the choice. You have the choice. We have the choice. I can either serve Jesus because he forgave me of all of my sins. He loved me enough to die for me. Man, I can work with that. I can love that kind of God. But Satan, he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. How many of you like to be robbed? I don't. How many of you like it when people die? I don't. How many of you like it when we look around and we see things being destroyed in our country or in our communities? We don't like that. So I can't deal with that kind of thing. So I will serve the Lord. And so Paul says, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about one God, Jesus Christ, who is the creator of all, and he has the power to bring you life, which is awesome. So, believing in idols is kind of a weak-minded idea. But Paul is not wanting to name call. He's not wanting to say, oh, you little Christian, you know, or you young in the Lord, or you little baby, spiritually speaking. He's just saying, hey, you olders need to understand that, in a sense, if you're the adult, spiritually speaking, you got little baby Christians that are watching you. How many times do you hear a little kid curse and swear, and it really causes you to turn your head, and you're like, where did that come from? Well, you know where it came from. Where did it come from? The parents, because the children are always a reflection of what is going on in the parents. And so the parents turn around, oh, I told you never to say that. It doesn't make sense to them because you say it all the time, mom, dad, whatever it might be. Paul is trying to get us to understand we need to be considerate about the young little ones. We don't want to deceive them. However, verse 7, not all believers understand this idea of idols are not gods. And so if you eat the meat that was offered to them, what's it going to do to you? Nothing. You know, I mean, a rock never did anything. You know, a chunk of wood didn't do anything that was carved out. So that hasn't done anything for you, but Jesus did. And if you are free in Christ, you are what? Free indeed. However, Paul would say, not all believers really understand this idea. Some are accustomed to thinking of idols as being real. So they eat the food that has been offered to the idols or when they eat food that has been offered to idols, they think of it as worship of the real gods, and their weak consciences, not weak minds, but conscience, their conscience bothers them. And they feel as though they are violating God's law. It is true that we can, or that we can't win God's approval by what we eat, or we don't lose anything if we do eat or we don't eat. So there's nothing to gain if you are a Christian vegan or a Christian carnivore. I mean, there's nothing to gain there, except maybe, hey, that was a tasty steak. You know, I love those ribs. That was great. But what you do have to lose is a young believer in Christ Jesus. You're going to cause them, you can cause them to fall back into the idea that when I step into Zeus's barbecue hut, you know, that if I'm eating a big old tomahawk steak or whatever it might be, and that young believer sees me go in or sees me sitting there, they're going to say, wow, maybe the belief in other gods is okay because Paul went in there and he had a big old steak. I watched them. I know that was sacrificed over here to Zeus. And so maybe it is okay to believe in those things and whatnot. The problem is they're going to drift off where? Toward the Lord or away? Paul says you got to be careful with these young ones. They don't understand the way we do. And so you can't just go sit at Zeus's barbecue and, you know, or Aphrodite's shish kebab house or whatever it might be. Okay, you just can't do that. You should probably order Grubhub and eat it at home, you know, something of that nature. It's not wrong to eat it. That's what he's saying. But I want you to be paying more attention, Paul would say, to loving that young little one in the Lord, spiritual young one in the Lord. Because it doesn't matter if we eat it or we don't. There's nothing that has anything to do. Because if that were the case, then getting to heaven would be easy. It would just be, well, then don't eat the meat, just eat the veggies, right? We'd all be vegans and we wouldn't eat anything and we're all on our way to heaven. But you and I know that that's not the case. You know that there's got to be some forgiveness in life. So Paul would say, hey, you need to be careful. Verse 9, but you must be careful so that your freedom does not cause others with weaker conscience to stumble. So order Grubhub, order it in, or whatever the case may be. For if another sees you with your, quote, superior knowledge, and knowledge does what? Puffs up. Oh, little one, you just don't understand. I am free in Christ to do these things. I don't know what you're talking about. That just seems like an excuse to me, the little one might say, you know, in the Lord. So what if you have this knowledge, Paul would say, it's just puffing you up. You're basically now a spiritual bully. I can do what I want. I'm a Christian, and I know that there's only one way to heaven. I don't care if I eat meat. If that person isn't strong enough to do it, then fine. After all, you know, we were all just kind of exploded into life here, and it's survival of the fittest. So if you're not spiritually, you know, fit, then too bad for you. Paul's like, no. That's not what it's about. Your freedom does not give you the right to stumble a little one. You just don't have that right. So Paul would say, for others will see you with your superior knowledge, which puffs up, eating in the temple of an idol, and won't they be encouraged to violate their conscience by eating food that has been offered to an idol? So this isn't just so much the eating of the meat. They're saying, oh, it must be okay to do these things. So then let's put some application here to this. Because how many times do we see meat being offered to idols these days? You know, I'm sorry. I can't tell you when the last time I saw meat being offered to an idol. I've never seen it. Why? We live in America, which was a godly nation, so we didn't do those kinds of things. But here's the thing. What is idolatry? What can be idols in our lives today?
Something you put before Christ.
Anything that we put before Christ. Money, our vehicles, relationships. There are so many things, but anything that takes the place of Jesus in our lives, that can become an idol. And so, when it comes right down to it, Paul would say, you have got to be careful. And now, wrapping things up, and no, I won't take 35 minutes to do it, as Lisa indicated on her last Facebook post. But it was great. I loved it. I was laughing so hard.
She did, yeah.
But if you know me, I can't wrap anything. So all of my presents are given in bags. I am quite certain that a man created those. But, okay, getting off track here. But verse 11, so because of your superior knowledge, a weak believer for whom Christ died. Did Christ die for you? Yes, he died for them too. So you're at the same level now, aren't you? So because of your superior knowledge, the weaker believer who doesn't understand the freedoms in Christ yet, who Christ died for will be destroyed. It's not that they might be, it's they will be. If they see what you're doing in worshiping money or your job or, you know, partnerships or whatever it might be, that is taking, but when they see that, that's what they're going to chase after. They're going to say, this is Christianity. This is what it means. And that is not of God. And if that's not of God, then it's of Satan. And Satan comes to what? Steal, kill, and they're going to be destroyed. You can't send them off on there. You and I have got to be the example. As mature Christians in Jesus, it isn't about what you get to do in Christ. It's about the love that you get to share in Christ. After all, what did Jesus do for you? Did he come upon the scene flashy in a big hotel in the royal suite and came down? He's like, that's it. Everybody out of the pool. I'm taking over. Jesus didn't do that, did he? He was born in a trough, in a slobber trough for animals. And, you know, he was a nobody to the people. They didn't even recognize him when they came to arrest him. They had to have Judas give him a kiss on the cheek to betray him because he was so ordinary and so average that they didn't even know who he was, the Romans, to come and arrest him. But yet, did he love? Absolutely. Did he ever turn anybody away? Yes, there was only one people that he ever did turn away. Who was it? The religious people. The religious priests, right? So these priests over here in Corinth are offering idols and sacrifices and all that other stuff. But, oh, we Jewish priests over here, we're doing things the right way. Oh, really? He yelled at them, turned over the tables, said, you're ripping off my people. My house isn't about a garage sale. My house is to be a house of prayer. This is where people are supposed to come for forgiveness. The church is about forgiveness, and what is it about? Money, money, money. You would bring your little lamb because that's all you could afford. They would look at it. They would inspect it. They'd find a spot and say, nope, sorry. This is not a perfect lamb, but we do have a pre-approved USDA stamped, you know, that this one is ready for worship of the Lord, and you can make that as a sacrifice for your sins. And then we'll buy your little lamb, but sorry, it's got a spot. We can only pay a dollar. Well, what does that one cost? Well, that one's $100. Oh, my goodness. It was a con, the entire thing. Because then we'd take that little lamb, go in there, spray paint it, and oh, we got another perfect lamb here for you. It was a scam. Jesus was more frustrated at those who knew what was right and didn't do it than he ever was at the sinners of this world that really didn't understand how bad sin was in their lives, and he forgave them, he loved them, but the ones who should have known and obeyed said, no, we're not going to do it. So what really the Lord is saying here is, if you know what's right and you don't do it, then it is sin. And when you sin against another, or when you sin against other believers by encouraging them to do something they believe is wrong, then you are sinning against Christ. It may not be wrong to you, but if you enforce, in a sense, oh, you don't know what you're talking about, just come with me, it's fine, then you are sinning against the Lord. And that is a bad place to be. So, verse 13, so if what I eat causes another believer to sin, then I will never eat meat again as long as I live, for I don't want to be the cause. I like that. Personal responsibility, Paul says here. I do not want to cause another young believer in the Lord to stumble. So Paul is simply saying, not let's eat. Let's just go in and eat and grab something. No, it's okay. Don't worry about it. We have freedom in Christ. Grace, grace, grace. We can do whatever we want. God forgives us. Paul would say, that's sin. But rather, he would say, if it's going to cause somebody else to sin, then in love, I will never do it again. If there's any chance at causing somebody to stumble, then I will never do it again. So it's not let's eat, but rather let us love one another the way the Lord loved us. Amen? So Father, let us do just that. Let us love one another the way you would have us to. Lord, it's easy to think about our freedoms in you, especially when we who know the scriptures well and say, hey, I just don't have a problem with that. It's not that big of a deal. But yet, Lord, we should always be wondering, Lord, is there another young believer who is looking at us and saying, hey, maybe I should do that too. If that's what being a Christian is, then I guess it's okay for me to do these things as well. Father, let us never think that way, but rather in love say, you know what? Somebody might question this, and so I'm not going to do it. Lord, let us be that obedient to you, that we make sure that we are leading the young away from destruction, away from Satan, and to you, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Thank you, Lord, that we can apply this message that the Corinthians learned years ago to our lives today. May we continue to hide your word in our heart that we might not sin against you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Well, God bless you.
Hey, Kirk.
Have a great day.
Hey, Kirk.
Yeah.